You have to catch their attention. And if you're losing their attention somehow because you're saying too many things, then you're going to lose me. And it's the same for the interviewer. You need to make sure you retain their attention as much as you can with things they're going to remember after the interview about positive things of why you would be the good fit for the role.
So Kim, thank you for taking out your time to be a part of this video. I really appreciate it.
I'm super happy to be here. Thank you for having me, Nikhil.
So the very first thing which I want to understand is how to create that first impression. Now, creating a first impression is very important. And an interviewer tends to realize or tends to understand whether a candidate is fit for a role within the first few minutes itself. So how should one approach this?
I totally agree with you. And I think even more so now, you know, the first impression is the most important one. So it's very important to create a positive impression at the beginning. And funnily enough, it doesn't actually last a few minutes. It only lasts 7 seconds. So you can imagine how quick 7 seconds is. It's like have a handshake and smile at the interviewer and that's already 7 seconds gone. Whereas if you're in a video setting, it's also even more complicated because you need to be able to break the ice in a bit more of an informal way while not using handshake and making sure that as much as you're stressed, you're going to remember to smile, etc. So it's very important. And you really want to make sure that despite this part for you, you nail this part. Because if you don't nail this part, then it will also dictate, for example, if the interviewer doesn't have a first great impression, it might impact on the timing that you would have for the interview. It might not be willing, you know, to get to know you a bit more. Maybe the interview will only last 20 minutes versus a 50-minute interview, which is an average on a good interview where people want to get to know a bit more about you.
Now, an interview normally starts with, tell me about yourself or run me through your CV. So how would you suggest one should answer this?
I think that's the most critical part. So after the first impression, the most important question is tell me about yourself. Because it's usually the first question that interviewer ask. And based on your answer, they will decide if they want to prolong the interview. Obviously, they will not cut it short right after the question. But they might say, for example, okay, I'll ask this person 2-3 more questions. And then that's it. So it's very, very important for you to be very mindful and to really prepare before you go in the interview, what would your answer be? And in that sense, I would invite you not to have a 5-minute long, answer, which some people tend to do because this is their opportunity if you want to tell the interviewer as much as they can about themselves. Whereas you should really like keep it to, I would say, 5 criteria because this is super important. You should break it down into 2 parts, and that's how I usually do it, and that's what worked with me every time in the past. You should start with who you are as a person, and you would take 60 seconds to answer that question with really, really key bullet points that you want to highlight. No blah, 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 where you are going to waste your time talking about it. And then the second part would be why you would be a good fit for this particular role. And in that sense, when you're talking about it, I would invite you to look at the job description for the particular role you're applying for, and then seeing from the responsibilities and the criteria, what really matches you as a person? Because the goal is also not to portray yourself as someone you're not, because even if you're hired, this might be an issue later on, you know, when you don't particularly have that skill. So you don't want to do that. But you would want to see, for example, for the 5 bullet points that they're asking you to be, maybe 2 or 3 match you as who you are as a person. So you would take these 2-3 bullet points and you would use it as your why and your who, so that they feel that, okay, there is a match between the role and this person and who we want to hire in the end. So it's very, very important. Don't try to, you know, give too many details. Don't try it. It's not about telling your life story. It's not about, you know, I want to tell him this. Maybe I won't have the opportunity to tell him that. You have to remember that same as you're listening to me now and same as our audience will be listening to us, you have to catch their attention. And if you're losing their attention somehow because you're saying too many things, then you're going to lose me. And it's the same for the interviewer. You need to make sure you retain their attention as much as you can with things they're going to remember after the interview about positive things of why you would be the good fit for the role. So you have 5 criteria. So for example, you would say if you're in a marketing role and the job description says you have to be creative, you have to be analytical, then you tell a bit more about who you are. So these are 5 points, not necessarily attributes, but five key points that you want to highlight between the who and the why of why you would be the right person for this role.
Now, tell me about your strengths or tell me about your weaknesses is quite a common question when it comes to an interview. So how would you suggest a candidate should frame this particular answer?
You don't want to say something that will burn you or will, you know, put you in jeopardy of not getting the role because I'm saying something that's bad. And at the same time, the problem is if you say things that recruiters know you're going to say because they're expecting everyone to say the same things, and that's obviously more on weaknesses than on strength, they either will tell you, think you're not being truthful, and they will, you know, poke you on the time and saying you're not being truthful, or, you know, this is what everyone says. So maybe you can tell me a bit more about who you are and what your weakness is. And that maybe might stress you a bit more, or you wouldn't be ready for it. So I would really invite you to think about it before and really think about it versus the job and the role you're applying for. For example, your strengths, I think, are easier because more or less people know what their strengths are. And that's easy to highlight. Also versus a job description of who they want, as we said, and tell me about yourself. Now, the weakness is a bit more tricky. And I would be very mindful of, at the same time, being true about who you are, but at the same time, also not saying something that will go against you. So for example, let's say we are talking about a marketing role. Yeah. And let's say, for example, you're not going to go and say in weaknesses, I'm not too analytical, if this is one of the requirements of your role. You're not going to say, I'm not too, I don't collaborate well, for example, if this job means you have to collaborate with teams. For example, I had a candidate that was applying for a marketing role. And we identified, okay, what would be something that would be okay maybe to say, but still look true or seem true in a sense. And we said, one thing was, she doesn't know how to say no. Now, obviously, this person was not super experienced because we have to be mindful. You don't have 10 years of experience. Maybe you have 2-3 years of experience. But, and also one critical thing you have to remember, whenever you position a weakness, you always have to flip it back in a sense that it will not become a positive, but you also always have to mention in the end that you are working on it and that you are learning things from it. So you are changing and flipping that weakness into something that's either neutral or becoming a positive strength, you know, because that's very important for people, for recruiters to understand that you are aware of what your weaknesses are, but you are also working on them. And that's very important for me. But please make sure that you don't say something that will hinder the job description itself. And don't say things that are overrated. Like, you know, we all say, for example, I'm a perfectionist, but I've learned to, you know, take a step back. And we always say, you know, I'm too detail-oriented or whatever, or I'm impatient and I think I see results fast. These are things that recruiters know that are out there that people recycle as questions. And be sure that whenever you have strengths and weaknesses, the most important thing, not just for this question, but anything that you say, you have to be ready to back it up with answers, with stories. So for example, if they feel that you're being true, you have something to back it up. And you can say, for example, this time this happened and I was able to overcome it.
Now, based on your experience, do you recommend a single page CV or do you recommend multiple pages? Also, how would you suggest one should format their resume?
This is tricky because I think it also differs by country. I've noticed that. So I'm coming from Lebanon and I've worked in both Paris and in the UAE. And it's very different, to be honest. In France and in Europe, it's mostly like you have to have a one-pager CV, no matter what. It's one page, no matter how many years of experience you have, it doesn't matter. In the UAE, I find it a bit different because sometimes they want you to include a bit more detail. Not to be too concise, but you have to be mindful. I would always recommend not to go more than 2 pages, not more than 2 pages, no matter what. Even if you have 10 years of experience, you will go for a 2-pager. Why? Because you will not talk about the experience you had 10 years ago. It's too early. Same as, for example, me now, if I have a long CV, I would remove my internships. I would remove things that are not really relevant right now or won't serve me for this role particularly. Because again, as we said, it's not about telling your life story. It's about the person understanding what are your core skills and how these core skills matches whatever they're looking for. And they know how many years of experiences you have. It's not about having everything written down there. I would be very mindful on how you're portraying your CV. I would have 2 types of CV and I'll tell you why. Because when you're applying online, you have an online tool that's called ATS. And some people might not be aware of it. but it's a tool that's done online that's tracking applications. So for example, I think a lot of people will be using it these days, especially because you have maybe thousands of applications for one role. And you know that a lot of people might not fit the role, might be overqualified, and they're applying for the role. What this ATS tracking tool does is it's like a matching kind of thing. So it will scan and analyze the CV, and it will give you a batch of what are the top matches that are matching your job requirements. So it's very important. I wouldn't say to have one CV for each role, because that's not the point. You cannot just have one CV for each role. You would have one cover letter for each role. Yes, definitely. And that we'll talk about it in a bit. But the CV, you would have one CV, I would say, for different job roles. So let's say, for example, you're applying in different roles in marketing or in social media. You're applying for a brand manager role, you're applying for a digital specialist role, things that are not very far from each other, but still, your CV would be different if you're applying for a brand manager role versus if you're applying for a digital specialist role. I would advise you to have also one that you would fit for the ATS online application for online, and one when you're sending it to by email, or when you're sending it, when you're taking it with you, for example, on the day of the interview, if you have a face-to-face interview, have a nicer looking one. Because ATS is a specific format where you can't have your picture, you can't have, for example, logos of the companies you've worked in, you need to have a specific font size, and these maybe will not make it look aesthetically very nice. Of course, it still needs to be organized and everything, but when you're sending it on email, you can have a bit of a nicer looking one, still while not exceeding the two-pager. And of course, at the top, it's always important, because some people might forget to put your name. Don't go into a full name. If you have a shorter name, try to have a shorter name, because I know some people might have four or five names, you know, as your name, but that's a bit complicated for people to remember. Then put your age. Don't put your date of birth. You're not asking the recruiter to do a calculation mentally and then calculate what it is. Just make it easy and simple for them to understand. You have to put, I would put my residential address, my nationality, my mobile number, my email address. And one thing that's important on email address, make sure it's professional, because some people might overlook it. Then you would have a summary, which is very important for your CV. Not more than four or five lines. Again, this is more about the tell me about yourself question. So think about it, who you are and what you want to highlight as a person. And five criteria. Again, don't go into over long, but you can say, for example, I have 8 years of experience in so-and-so. I am passionate. I'm whatever it is about you. But so that they have a glimpse of who you are as a person, on a personality-wise, but also professional attributes. Then after that, I would put my core competency skills. And this is something new. So for example, depending on the role that you're applying for, of course, your competencies would differ. Don't put 20 competency scores, because this means at the end, you don't know which one you really have. I would put maximum 10. And then you would go into your professional experience, obviously starting from the very recent to the previous one. You would highlight what your job details are. Some people like putting dates. I would also put, it's okay to put dates, but if I were you, I would also add a number of time, like for example, 2 years, 6 months. It's also easier for people to remember. And of course, the country where you were working in, like for example, if it's in Dubai, Paris, whatever it is. And then I would go into the projects. Again, don't put all of the projects you've worked on, because it's very important here to highlight what are the key criteria that people are looking for. And more importantly, what are the results that are coming from these projects? Because I can say, I've worked on X, I've worked on Z. That's very nice. But then the person wants to know, what is the result of you working this? How much turnover were you able to contribute? Because of course, it's not about on your own. But how, for example, how much turnover were you able to contribute? How, for example, X percent of market share you were able to get from this particular brand after X amount of time. And these things matter more than putting X amount of roles. I would put maybe maximum 6 or 7 pointers and really put what's important there. Then, of course, you would go maybe more into the languages, because I think it's very important, especially if you have more than two, your proficiency in each of these languages. And then your proficiency in terms of computer skills and any other software you work on. That's also important. And then I would put my educational. Don't put your school. So when I say educational, you maybe have, if you have a PhD, of course, you can add that. If you have certificates online that are accredited, I would invite you to add that. But don't put, for example, put certificate online, put master's, bachelor's. Don't put your school. even if you're a fresh graduate, it's a bit different because maybe your experience might be shorter, so you'd want to keep that, but don't just keep it to one. And try not to put, for example, if you're a professional, don't put the courses you've learned in high school or in, for example, in university and everything, unless these are really out of the box and super important for some particular role. It's important to just keep it brief and concise. And then in the end, I would add the extra curricular activity. I think it's important because it also gives a glimpse of what your personality is. Don't put 15, I would put maximum 5 again. And I would leave it at that. I wouldn't add my LinkedIn profile. People know it's easy for you to find it. I wouldn't add references in the sense that if they want references, they would ask you for it. I would keep it at this because you would want to keep it at 2 pages.
Now, while searching for jobs, candidates normally tend to share the same CV or the same resume with multiple different companies with the intent that they want to apply to as many number of companies as possible. Do you recommend this particular strategy?
Definitely not. Not on a normal time and even less so now. And I know it's very stressful in the sense that you're going through a market that's flooded with job applications and specific, like very limited roles. But no matter what the situation is, and I would say even more so now, I don't want to say you'd be wasting your time, but it's not about the quantity, it's about the quality. Sorry. It's not about sending, you can send 100 CVs a day. You can send 50 CVs a day. But at the end, if you're sending and clicking the button and sending the same template to everyone, I can almost guarantee you that's not going to get you anywhere. Even if you focus on sending, even if it's not 100, but 10 CVs a day or 5, whatever it is that you can do, the more you focus on sending the right application, the more chances you have of getting it back. And I know it's stressful. You'd want to apply to anything you see, any role you might see, even if it doesn't fit your profile, but it wouldn't lend you anything. Just try to see what fits your job role, even if it's a bit vertical if you want, but not so much as it's a completely different line of role. Make sure that you take your time to not only, as we said, have a template for each of the role description that you want, but also add a cover letter. And I know how tedious it is. You're like, no, I don't want to write a cover letter. It takes time, but it makes a difference. Even more so now. And when you write a cover letter, this is where I would say there is no template. You have to personalize it. If you can get the person's recruiter, even better, because then you can address it to them. You highlight the company name, but not just that. You also highlight why the particular role, it's the same as tell me about yourself, why you would fit this particular role and what makes you different. Because this is very important. People know when I've sent a cover letter that's, even if it's a recycled brand manager letter that I've sent to multiple, just changing the company name and everything, they know these things. So it won't serve you much. You're just also, again, wasting your time kind of thing. But these things matter. And don't just rely on the traditional CV approach. It doesn't work. It would work, but not much. Just do everything that you can. Networking, even if people don't like doing it. Some people are not familiar or not comfortable with networking. Even if you might not know the person, because we know on LinkedIn, it's not only close relationships. Maybe it's some people we don't know, but that's okay. But what do you have to lose if you just ask this person? They might not even respond. They might respond. You never know. But they understand the situation that you are in. And you never know. You might be able to get things, if they get across something later on. Just keep networking. Even if you can't do it on a face-to-face thing. People are doing it. People are being part of communities. You have to think about LinkedIn as your online CV. And that's another thing that's very important. LinkedIn has to be as detail-oriented and not as detailed. I mean, as detailed and as up to scratch as your offline CV is, because this is where they will go and check, and it needs to correlate with whatever you're saying on the offline CV.
And finally, due to the current market situation or due to COVID, the unemployment rate is much higher. So what advice would you give to all those applicants or every single candidate who is trying to look for a job or who's trying to get an interview?
True. And I think we've tackled that briefly when I said, you have to stand out from the clutter. You cannot just rely on a traditional CV. You have to network. You have to make sure, again, your CV stands out. How can you make sure, you have to look at yourself personally. If you're, for example, a graphic designer, other than showing your portfolio, if you're into video production, can you do something extra? Can you do something more? if you're applying, for example, for a social media role, for me, it wouldn't be just enough to apply for it or to network. Why don't you, for example, if you know that's one of the job requirements, show them what your added value will be. Study your competition or your website or the brand's website, whatever it is that's the job requirement is, and come up with something that really will make them feel like this aha moment, you know, where they feel like you've given them something of value. They feel like they feel important that you've taken time to actually look at it because you really want this role. You're not just applying for another role and you've taken your time to do your research and give them something that's valuable for them. And I think that's very, very, very important. And I think that's, I mean, I'm giving the example of social media, but of course, anything that's in your line of work, I would invite you to think, what can you bring as added value to this person? And give it, even if you're giving it for free, at the end, you're portraying a good version of yourself. I'm not saying you should write a book or you should, you know, give a full depth strategy and whatever their strategy is. No, that's not it, because we don't want to give free consultancy role. But even adding one small thing that makes them feel like she's done the exercise of actually, or he done the exercise of actually looking at the research and the job background and give me something really extra. And I think that will be very important for them to stand out. And we are saying preparation is key. You know how preparation is important. I would say, of course, it's good to improvise here and there. You don't want to make it look like it's a rehearsed speech in a sense. But you have to make sure that the important questions, you're prepared for them. And there are always going to be questions you're not prepared for or you might not expect. Make sure that you don't stress. Make sure that you know yourself better than anyone else. You know your professional experience. You know it. No one else knows it better than you. So you can defend yourself. You know what you want to highlight. So don't stress about it. Just think about it logically. And just think in a moment, what can I say that will really make a difference and really make me feel valuable and really make sure that what I'm saying now, the person will mostly remember. And I would invite you to do that with every single question. When I'm giving an answer, it's not about blah, blah, blah. It's about saying, from this answer, from this question, what can I say that would really make an impact, that would really make the interviewer remember me and put me on top of the candidate batch of roles. And I would say, also because now it's just one last thing I'd want to add, because I know how stressful it is at the moment. We've talked about quantity and quality and not quantity, but also be mindful that no matter how stressed you are, it's very important to disconnect, even if you wouldn't want to do it, even if you're not getting any answer. If you're going to go into burnout mode, it's not going to help you. You need to make sure you disconnect over the weekend with specific time. Like, for example, I don't know, up to you to decide, but you would say, I stop at 7 o'clock. For example, at night, I turn down my laptop. I do things that make me happy. I do things where I want to learn something more on a new skill. I want to learn a new language, whatever you're up to, because you have to make sure you're also recharging your batteries at the same time. It's super important, and it will help you be even more productive, you know, for the next week and the week after that, because it's also about being patient. These times you're not going to get, maybe hopefully you will, but you might not get to the job, you know, in 1 week or 2 weeks, might take maybe a few months. So you want to make sure you remain mentally sane as well to be able to proceed with your job search. You know, anyone can do it. Even if the job market is crowded now, there are still job opportunities that are there, and I want to help them get there. You know, it's all about sharing tips that might help them. I'm more than happy to connect with them, you know, but really it's about realizing what your value is, who you are, and that's what's going to make you stand out.